all boys, turrets, and teamwork. Oh my! Today, we're diving into the rough and rowdy zombie apocalyptic world of Turtle Rock Studios' Back for Blood. Zombies are one of gaming's core staples. You can't swing a dead cat into a GameStop without hitting a title that features zombies, or at least has a zombie mode in it. They're a classic combo you can always expect, like cheap hot dogs at a baseball game, or handsy Deadpool cosplayers at Comic-Con. And the genre has become pretty diverse. Zombies can be a product of a manufactured mutagen, made from plants, or even defeated by plants. And after a year of our own pandemic apocalypse, we could all use some co-op zombie-slaying human camaraderie. So how does Back for Blood, the Left 4 Dead 2 successor, hold up in the genre? Well, let's dive in and find out. Okay, first things first. What is Back for Blood? Well, Back for Blood is a multiplayer first-person shooter developed by Turtle Rock Studios, one of the original developers of the Left 4 Dead series. And Back for Blood is heralded as the spiritual successor to Left 4 Dead 2. In 2009, Turtle Rock Studios and Valve released Left 4 Dead 2, the sequel to Left 4 Dead. And despite the attempted boycott, Left 4 Dead 2 would go on to swarm the gaming world, quickly racking up mods, players, and ultimately becoming a beloved title. So it was no surprise that players were anxiously craving a third installment. But in 2010, Turtle Rock Studios split from Valve, leaving the future of the franchise even more up in the air. Valve owns the rights to the Left 4 Dead franchise, and clearly isn't planning on breaking their three-game curse anytime soon. Over the next 10 years, rumors would pop up here and there of a Left 4 Dead 3 in development, but nothing was ever fully confirmed. Finally, at the Game Awards 2020, the first look at Back 4 Blood debuted nearly a decade after the split. And needless to say, fans were rightfully hyped. It was a glimmer of hope after the end of such a rough year, the return of a first-person zombie-smashing favorite. In Back 4 Blood, you find yourself immersed in a post-apocalyptic world overrun with what's known as the Devil Worm, a parasitic virus that takes over its human host. But this isn't your everyday run-of-the-mill zombie virus. No, this is a zombie virus from outer space. That's right, the Devil Worm crash-landed on our planet and was actually first discovered in Quebec. Unfortunately, Canada couldn't contain the worm, much like they couldn't contain Justin Bieber, and this malicious parasite quickly made its way into the United States, which, well, leads us to where we are today. Wow, Canada, your universal healthcare, 20% of fresh water in the world, and being the largest consumer of macaroni and cheese couldn't hold back the zombie apocalypse. Disappointing, eh? But humanity hasn't given up hope. Literally, you find yourself stationed at Fort Hope and take on the role of one of the cleaners, a group of immune survivors fighting for humanity's survival. And what's a zombie game without, well, zombies? Throughout your post-apocalyptic crusade, you'll come across various unique types of Ridden among the common hordes, like Mr. Handsy, Splody, Grabber, and Snitches Get Pitches. Okay, these are not their official names. Rather, these are the names that I have lovingly bestowed upon them. Feel free to use them at your will. So how is Back 4 Blood's gameplay? Well, it boils down to two words, choice and cooperation. Choice is a powerful tool throughout many video games, but in Back 4 Blood, it is especially prominent. Choice boils down to your playstyle, which cleaner you select, how you spend your copper, etc. For instance, Hoffman, aka the History Channel Aliens guy, has an automatic plus 10% max team ammo capacity bonus simply because he has cargo pockets. They're fashionable and functional. Within each level, you also have the choice of which weapons and items to pick up or purchase, such as a toolkit that can access locked rooms and miniguns, or the shock to the heart device that can make people alive again. But arguably, the most extensive form of choice comes from Back 4 Blood's unique card system. This system creates a tailored gameplay experience similar to that in Slay the Spire, and is a refreshing expansion to the multiplayer FPS zombie genre. During each round of gameplay, you draw cards from your deck that will actively help you in each level. These cards range from damage benefits, health boosts, group abilities, you get the idea. Once you start to unlock more cards, building your own custom decks to fit your playstyle can be a lot of fun. Whenever we would run into a level that featured an excessive amount of hordes with little cover, I would often pick a custom deck I built that featured cards with melee bonuses and health buffs. Or even one of our producers kitted out her deck with a ton of offensive projectile bonuses because she loved throwing Molotov cocktails.
Let's watch it burn! Flames! Oh, the gasoline barrel too! Please be cocktails behind this door! No!
Maybe a little too much. Deck and active cards can make or break a level, but you're not the only one dealing in this decimated domain. Meet the game director, Turtle Rock Studios AI that actively affects your game with challenges via corruption cards. Corruption cards are dealt out at the beginning of each campaign level and are sometimes added randomly during the game if the director feels particularly sadistic. For example, the director can deal an environmental challenge such as fog that makes it practically impossible to see who or what is coming at you, which can be stacked on top of an armored tallboys card, shard-ridden card, and a jogging swarm. Delightful. But it's frustrating, and I mean truly frustrating as the game director can be. It does manage to keep you on your toes and offers decent replayability. Even if you're going at your second run at a level, you may not encounter the same weapons, enemies, or even accessible areas as your previous playthrough. Which brings me to one of my bigger gripes with the game, the difficulty scale. Back 4 Blood features three difficulty options: Survivor, Veteran, and Nightmare. The producer and I started on Veteran with the idea of, yes, we're experienced gamers who have played years of first-person shooters. But even us and the two strangers we were fighting alongside had our asses handed to us in the first level because the game decided to throw everything it had right out of the gate at the medium difficulty. Some levels would take the rest of the G4 TV crew and me multiple runs to complete, while on the other hand, we breezed through the finale of Act 1, honestly shocked that we completed it so effortlessly without anyone needing to be revived. For those of us that don't find our sense of personal value out of demolishing every game we play and letting all 10 people know about it on Reddit, the fact that Back 4 Blood lacks a genuine and consistently casual mode is a strange self-inflicted wound. Adults with limited time use multiplayer both as a social experience as much as a challenge, and getting three other friends together is something of an achievement in its own right. That the game requires a high level of skill from all players at the outset just to become acquainted with the maps, which in turn should foster the desire to try the maps on harder settings, narrows the appeal considerably. Because trust me, that AI ain't cutting it.
Evangelo, no!
Evangelo!
Tell me you're recording this.
I am.
Good.
You know what? He deserves it. Die, Evangelo, die.
Yeah.
Look, there's a lot of fun to be had with this game, if circumstances allow. But if you have a child, a job, someone in your life you might want to spend time with, or God forbid, interests outside of video games, then finding four friends with enough skill and patience and time to put into Back 4 Blood, well, that's going to really limit its appeal and longevity in a lot of game libraries. A steep learning curve keeps the riffraff out. But honestly, some of the best parties are mostly riffraff, and not the Richard O'Brien kind.
Hello.
Speaking of co-op, it's time to talk about the other main component of Back 4 Blood, cooperation. Working together as a team is one of the best aspects of this title. This includes choosing cards that can help the group, taking point on specific missions, working together to plan out your means of attack, or simply covering your buddies as you bum rush through the local old abandoned mineshaft. There are various levels throughout the game that are built explicitly for cooperation, from guarding players as they load shells into cannons to collectively searching for research cases in a dilapidated mansion. There is a reason why the game's slogan is "Slay together, stay together," and not "Slay by yourself, stay down when you get pinned by a hawker," because yes, that will happen if you go off on your own, Brian. I played a few rounds on my own, both jumping into random matches and in solo mode, which pairs you with bots, and it was an okay experience. Between the silent strangers and bots, both were fairly efficient, give or take some bot shenanigans, which was fine, but when I was online with friends, the stakes were that much higher and that much more fun. The highs were super high and the lows just fueled us to try again, which is exactly what you want from a game like this. This leads us to our deeper discussion about the two different modes of Back 4 Blood, Campaign and Swarm. Back for Blood's co-op campaign is the core of the game. It's the meatier of the two modes and provides a lot of challenges. While there are primarily three types of gameplay scenarios in Back for Blood, shoot and move forward, stand your ground, run. The level design itself is of significant variety until the finale. That keeps it feeling fresh and inventive. You may be causing a ruckus in a local bar to draw nearby ridden hordes one moment, to setting timed explosives on a ferry and watching it light up the night sky. But as expansive as the gameplay is in the campaign, the narrative is a bit lackluster. I mean, you get a sense of what you're supposed to do each mission. You've got to get from point A to point B, you've got to rescue some survivors, or you've got to be able to find some supplies, etc., etc. But it's really tough to tell what the overall story of the game is. NPCs provide exposition in various safe rooms at the beginning of each level, but during those moments, I'm much too busy strategizing with my team and purchasing items to pay attention. The narrative sits in a weird limbo. There's definitely more than Left 4 Dead 2, but not enough to feel like a robust story-led game. But while the narrative may not stand out, it's the characters who truly shine. Similar to the Left 4 Dead series, Back 4 Blood features a colorful cast of memorable characters. Depending on who is in your party, you may hear focused tidbits about their pasts or temperaments. Like the fact that Walker doesn't have anyone else in the world outside of his cleaner family. Carly is plagued with terrifying nightmares, and Hoffman accidentally killed his elementary school teacher as a kid. I'm just forever grateful that dialogue in a zombie game has drastically improved from this.
That was too close. You were almost a Jill sandwich.
Oh, that never gets old. Each character is packed to the brim with personality, thanks to the brilliant writing and equally fantastic voice acting. It's honestly hard to pick just one favorite since they all bring something unique to the fight, which makes creating parties of different character combinations that much more fun on each campaign playthrough. Now that we've tackled the campaign, let's dive into Swarm Mode. One of Left 4 Dead 2's staples was its PvP mode. So, how does this spiritual successor compare? Well, not as strongly. In Swarm, players fight in a 4v4 timed battle. One team of four takes on the role of the cleaners, while the other four are various special ridden. Your goal, as the cleaners, survive the multiple waves of hordes and player ridden for as long as you can. But as they're ridden, just f*** up the cleaners, hopefully in a coordinated manner, like vomiting all over them, or leaping towards them like a spider monkey. Oh yes. The spider monkey was my signature move in middle school. Once the first round is finished, the teams switch roles, and the new cleaners must survive as long as the first team. The swarm match is concluded when the best out of three is won. More than anything, Swarm feels like a combination of Left 4 Dead 2's survival mode and Turtle Rock Studios' other title, Evolve, but messier and a bit more confusing. And from my experience, each swarm match fits into one of three categories. Both teams know what they're doing strategically. One team knows what they're doing strategically. No teams know what they're doing strategically. Only one of these scenarios leads to fun and rewarding gameplay. I'm going to give you a hint. It's not option three. Even if the difficulty was limiting, I felt a lot more inclined to return and beat the campaign with friends. I never felt that pull towards Swarm. After two rounds of having my ass handed to me by a clearly coordinated team, I did not want to touch that mode with a 6-foot tall boy arm. Although Turtle Rock has stated there are no current plans to add additional PvP modes, I hope that is not the case. When your game only has two modes, and one is exceptionally weaker, it's not a promising sign for longevity. Overall, if you're looking for Left 4 Dead 3, you may not find all of it in Back 4 Blood, which is something of a double-edged sword, or a double-edged zombie-slaying machete for bringing Left 4 Dead 2 into your marketing mix. The positives of referencing Left 4 Dead 2 are that you can link gamers' nostalgia for that title and build excitement for this spiritual successor. The bad? Well, you also bring in the expectations of Left 4 Dead 2, and if you don't perfectly serve up everything fans want, namely compelling PvP, then you open yourself up to a lot more criticism. Back 4 Blood is an entertaining game under particular circumstances. The best way to experience it is with friends, especially friends of the same skill level. And for the most part, the game offers a decent amount of replayability. Each level provides a diverse range of challenges and excitement. And from the card system and the characters alone, you can often find yourself desiring to play again for the thrill. I want to try this level just with my medic deck, or can I succeed without triggering any birds, etc. But the often jarring difficulty discrepancy and lack of a genuinely engaging PvP mode make it weaker than the spiritual successor it wants to be. Back for Blood is for sure a thrilling first-person shooter and a fun new group game to spice up your friends' list. But I would drop your Left 4 Dead expectations and treat this as a brand new game that has just dropped in time for spooky season. So, as I mentioned, this game really, really sings if you're playing it with friends. So as a result, I have brought the friends that I both acquired and got to play with, two of them, and that is Ovely and Frosk. Thank you for joining today, and thank you for spending several days all together shooting zombies in the face and not yelling at one another too much.
Yeah, I needed to hear the too much, because I think that towards the end, we did get to the part where some of my esports came out, and I started shot calling, potentially just a little aggressively.
At that point, I think also a sense of multi-day exhaustion had set in, and I was like, oh, cool. You know, and we needed it in those. I mean, we can talk about that in a second, but that, I think, slightly questionable design for the final section of the game. But let's start with that broad-based question. Frost, you can take it first. Is this the Left 4 Dead 3 that people have wanted? Does it kind of fill that void?
That is the banger question. I would say yes when it's being Left 4 Dead. And Back 4 Blood does feel to me like the old school Left 4 Dead days. But when I think about it, how long ago it was when you're playing with friends, you're in a college dorm room, everything is stacked up with like something crusty or like leftover beer cans. And I think it fits in that niche really well. But the thing is that we're, you know, close to a decade past that. And I think that's where things get a little bit interesting for me for Back 4 Blood.
Yeah, I believe it was a decade ago. I'm still thinking about the dorm room, knowing where I was playing it in a cube next to Abby Heppy at an old G4.
We had very different experiences.
Yes. Ovely, I'm assuming you weren't playing it in a dorm room either when Left 4 Dead 2 came out.
She was in kindergarten.
So either as someone who played it or someone who is actually new to the franchise, does this fill sort of a cooperative action void that has been lacking?
So for me, Left 4 Dead 2 was one of the first, like, multiplayer games that I had played with high school friends when I was just coming in as a freshman. So I was still playing out of my childhood bedroom. But I came to Left 4 Dead 2 a little bit late. So the Left 4 Dead 2 that I came into was like super modded, where all of us were playing as anime characters and the witch was Hatsune Miku and she would sing "World Is Mine" as soon as, you know, you startled her or something. But for me, playing this game with you guys and with friends and even with randoms, it really fulfilled kind of like that nostalgia factor where, you know, I'm getting carried by Frosk, I'm just working on trying to like revive people, or I'm just hoarding all the ammo to myself even though I'm not doing anything. And then just kind of seeing the stress levels start to rise. And to me, that's very fulfilling of Left 4 Dead 2 for me. And that's why I love the game so much.
It's interesting that you hit on the nostalgia factor, because not only with this game, but I think something like Metroid Dread and some other games that are coming out, or games that are being remastered and reissued ad infinitum at the latter half of this year. How much, Frost, do you think that this sort of trades on nostalgia versus, you know, trying to sort of make improvements, changes, alterations to give it more of a contemporary feel?
I definitely don't want to like short the devs here, because for all we know, this could have been just like a massive passion project. I think it'd feel like pretty shitty. It'd be like, oh, you know, it's just they're banking on nostalgia again to like make money, when maybe they were like, you know, really grinding. They had to completely leave Valve to make like their dream project. And I think the game is really polished for what it does well. But I think, again, in the contemporary sense, you have cool things where they added the deck feature. It feels much more kind of like a roguelite, where you get to make a build. And I was experimenting with different builds, and I really did feel different power when I was experimenting with my cards, which I thought was really cool. The gunplay is super smooth. The graphics look beautiful. But it just feels so small in terms of what it offers you. Like, it offers you a very specific experience, but not a wide range of experiences. If you have friends, if you're playing as four in the campaign mode, I think that's where it shines best. PvP, not so much. Any of the other modes, not so much. And my issue is that right now in the field of games, we have these AAA beautiful titles that can kind of do all of that and more. So if you want the Left 4 Dead experience, Back 4 Blood is amazing for that. If you want something like the Left 4 Dead experience and then something added on top of it, I think Back 4 Blood comes up short.
I mean, obviously there is the Swarm mode, which is kind of an inexplicable title for what it is, which is PvP, which I think that I know I did, I know you did, obviously we haven't heard from you. I felt it was a little half-baked, and I didn't see much draw For that, and that, you know, a PvP player going for that, I think will find themselves woefully disappointed. But I agree with you completely on what the campaign is, and to the extent that it's a roguelike, whatever. Like, they don't even hide that fact. Like, they call each act a run.
Yeah.
It's using the vernacular that is part of the roguelike experience. Obviously, I think that, you know, we talked about in the review that there is a fair amount of challenge. I think that, you know, we got stymied. I guess it felt more uneven in terms of its challenge than anything else, even at that easiest setting. As someone who, as you said earlier, you love the challenge and the shot calling and stuff like that. In your experience with cooperative games or games where you play cooperative against other human beings, how did it compare in that regard?
So I'm going to be completely honest with you. As soon as we finished our run, I went back and spoke with my friends who, I guess, did as much of the campaign as was available in the beta. And I was like, oh my gosh, easy mode is actually pretty difficult. And they looked at me and they're like, what the hell are you talking about? We completed the entire beta on like hardcore mode. And the only reason why we didn't do nightmare is because it was like overtuned in difficulty. And I'm just staring, looking at them, and I'm like, what do you mean you finished on hardcore mode? We're all struggling with easy baby hold your hand mode. So I think that experiences are tailored, you know, very differently tailored to whatever familiarity level you have with these games. I think for all of us going in, we all know Left 4 Dead, we're all cool with it. But none of us have ever played a game like this before. And I think that's kind of like...
Nor have we played together.
Or, yeah, exactly,
I think that's another factor.
Yeah.
And that's the thing, is as we mentioned in the review, I'm just going to make some presumptions and scream at me if I'm wrong. I'm assuming your friends know each other well. I assume your friends are on the younger side, and I assume your friends play games together quite a bit. And that, I can easily see, that game becomes... absolutely, I think, almost a must-have in that situation, because I even felt like, ooh, I would love to do that level again and see if we can do it better. And the game is very much designed that you're supposed to actually continue playing, because your weapons are only going to get improved, you're going to find better weapons, you're going to get that. But for what I really do believe is the majority of people, for the game to be commercially viable, that to not have a mode where, you know, people of my age... like, I have my best friend and I never get to play games with him. I play games with his son more, but he has a job, he has a son, he has a wife, he has other responsibilities. That for that type of person, which there are many of them that like to get together with friends, maybe once a week to play a Battlefield or something like that, this doesn't offer, like, you've got to be playing it with relative consistency. You've got to actually have all four players engaged and have a fair amount of experience, that the party aspect of the game, that I think there was something that was part of the Left 4 Dead series, which was just sort of the laughing and screwing up and all that. It doesn't serve that very well. And it seems to be narrowing its appeal, which I think is a bigger issue, given the fact that, you know, there is kind of, like, with the Ultimate Edition, stuff like that, there's a quasi-Battle Pass, there's going to be DLC, and I think that you'd want to engage as broad an audience as possible at the outset to then have those antecedent, you know, purchases. And I think if you create that much frustration with the less experienced group of players, like, this thing is, you know, it's going to become, like, you know, the Dark Souls people.
That was actually something that I was thinking about after we had finished, I think, Sunday or whatever. I think that Back 4 Blood would really benefit from an ultra baby mode feature or something like this. And I don't mean, you know, all of the zombies do like zero damage to you or whatever, but usually when you play with a group of friends and you're close friends and you know that you just have one person who has absolutely no idea what they're doing, but they're part of the squad, so you gotta let them in. I would love to see a feature where just you indicate one person as the baby, you put the little bonnet on their head or something, some sort of identifier, little wah, wah, whenever you take damage or something like that. And you just add this feature in where this person cannot die. They revive people in 2 seconds, but they cannot die. That way they can still enjoy the game. They aren't like a total dead weight nuisance to their team, and they get to continue and share in that experience with the whole squad and everything. And then, of course, like, if you're part of the squad, they're clowning on you. Like, they're like, oh, okay, I hear you crying. Are you taking damage? Do you need me to come save you? And it becomes a feature.
A lot of friends do that. Yeah. I think there's a lot of merit there. Frost, you were going to say something.
I was just thinking, like,
So the things that I really loved about this game were kind of the experiences, like the Mario Party or party game atmosphere that can only really be created in these types of genres, and I think only can really be created by Left 4 Dead and now Back 4 Blood because of the zombie element. Like things like, I will never forget, Adam, hearing you say, "Why am I on fire?" as you came around the car and you were chased by a horde of flaming zombies. Or when the hawker was leaping towards us and we shot it in midair, like right before it hit us, and simultaneously all of us go, "Whoa!" Or like having one of us like get smacked across a map and you just see like Emily's body go flying or something like that. Like these types of moments are just like so, the only word I can think of is like hardcore rock and roll metal fun, which I think is like the perfect description of that series. And like that's the only place that that exists in is when Back 4 Blood is at its best. So if you like that, this is an amazing game for that.
Yeah. I mean, I think that's the thing, is that it's good for challenge. It does present the joy, I think, facilitating a little bit more joy and not just, you know, the idea of like, I win, would do a lot to assist this game in its persistent longevity, whatever that means. That's just a fancy word of me saying,
DLC.
Hey, thank you so much for joining me and obviously joining me when we were playing the game, because that was a blast. And it really proves this game is so much fun with friends. I'm glad I have you as friends.
This was me cocking my shotgun, and then I was going to go shoot a zombie.
That's not what it looks like, babe.
How do I cock a shotgun?
Not like that.
Thank you so much for watching. If you want another review, please go check out my controversial review of Far Cry 6. And if you want something that's more horror-tinged, you have got to check out the secretish history of the original Silent Hill. All right, with that and all this talk of the apocalypse, I need to go check on my emergency stock of toilet paper.